Morning. Let's give it a moment. I'll give it one more minute and we'll get going. All right, why don't we just get moving here. So, all right. This is a tracing that Jeff Vinokur, who's a EP doctor at Yale, posted on Twitter just a few week or two ago, a patient with a history of syncope while playing basketball. And this is a stress test tracing 3 minutes into the study. So presumably the treadmill is moving. And this is what was observed. So I guess the first question I would say is, what would you do at this point, if anything? And any thoughts on diagnosis or treatment? So why don't I start with Maya? What do you think?
Let's see. So. So if I see this, so it looks like we are initially, there's a few beats of bigeminy.
Mm-hmm. I agree fully.
And then it's kind of just these this like intermittent ectopy. Just on first glance, I would think that these are PVCs. To be sure, I would want to, you know, use calipers and march it out. So, I mean, I think with this level of like ectopy and bigeminy, I would probably want to terminate the stress test.
Okay. Hard to argue with that, but do you have any thoughts on what condition would, what do you think about these PVCs? Are they monomorphic or polymorphic?
They look polymorphic.
I'd agree, right? They don't all look the same. The first PVC on the left-hand side of the screen, and then the second one, which is the one, two, the fourth bead of the tracing, right? Doesn't look, they certainly don't look, they're kind of similar, but not really, right? These two beads.
Yeah.
Kind of different. And then this bead here, right? This doesn't really look like any of the prior ones. In fact, this one seems to be going down. This one going up, almost as if they have two different axes completely. Similarly, these don't look exactly the same either. So what do you think this could be? So your patient has a history of syncope while playing basketball. So we're going to presume for the sake of conversation that you would, you know, if you had a patient who came to you in clinic and had, you heard this story, what would you be thinking in your mind in just in terms of differential diagnosis? Forget about the stress test that we're doing now. Mm-hmm. What would you do to work a patient like this up? First of all, is that concerning to you that a patient would have syncope while playing basketball? Let's assume this is a teenager.
Yeah, that would be concerning to me. Uh-huh. Especially like, I guess we'd, characterize the syncope more, but if it was, like a sudden event during exercise, that would concern me for things like long QT syndrome or like ARVC. Mm-hmm. Or I guess like CPVT.
CPVT, yeah. Mm-hmm. And any other conditions? What would be the most common reason that somebody who was exercising and had and fainted?
Like a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Right, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy always should be in your mind as number one, because that is, in fact, at least in the United States and in most of the world, except for certain areas of Italy, Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is the first most common reason. Like when you hear that somebody has died on a playing field, for example, always you should be thinking at least first in your differential is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. But certainly I agree that all those other things like long QT, ARVC, CPVT, all of those are potential causes of sudden arrest with exertion. Could this be vasovagal syncope? I'll flesh out the story. Let's say he just scored a point and he's you know, running back on defense to the other side of the court. And while he's running towards to defend the next basket, he faints. That's the story. And he wakes up after about a second or two on the ground. So that's the story. So first of all, would that, is that a worrisome finding? Can that be consistent with neurocardiogenic syncope or vasovagal syncope, which would generally be a relatively benign diagnosis?
I mean, I guess it could, but I would think that would be lower down in my differential.
Yeah, I mean, generally speaking, exertional syncope almost never is vasovagal, it certainly is the absolute diagnosis of exclusion. Okay, you have to prove that all those other bad things that you mentioned are not in fact the case. So this is a very, very, very important point. If you ever hear about somebody, this is why taking a history is so important, which is that people, you have to find out exactly when this happened. You know, sometimes people said they were playing basketball, but really what happened was they went to the bench, they sat down for a few seconds, they stood up and they fainted. That's very different, right, than somebody who in mid-action faints, you know, goes to the ground. When someone goes to the ground while actually in the middle of an athletic activity, that is a very, very worrisome observation that deserves an extremely careful evaluation. Okay, so the patient comes to the ER, they are in sinus rhythm and their ECG looks normal. Let's assume for the sake of this discussion that these beats here is sort of what the EKG looked like when the patient came to the emergency room. So what would your workup be then, Maya?
In the ER. So, I mean, I would probably want to get an echo, I guess. I don't know if it has to be like an emergency or done right away, but I think it should be done like relatively soon. Yeah.
Would you send the patient? Okay. So let's say it's 9 o'clock on Friday evening. Okay. Mm-hmm. Patient is now fine, is in sinus rhythm in the emergency room. Would you send such a patient home and say, we're going to work it up on Monday? How would you manage that? Let's say you're a first year fellow and you're only in your first week and you really can't do an echo by yourself. And so what would you do? Or alternatively, all the echo machines are being serviced that weekend. There's no echo machines available that night. There will be one tomorrow, not at night.
Okay. If there's really no ability to do an echo overnight, I think that's probably okay. I would just give the patient instructions to not, you know, do strenuous physical activity.
Okay. So let's say you could do an echo and the echo looked to your eye normal. Okay. Send such a patient home. But there's no real right answer. You could do what you just said, which is say, come back on Monday to clinic and we'll do a further evaluation. And in the interim, please don't do any activity other than, you know, activities of daily living, no sports. That's not unreasonable. Mm-hmm. But usually if something this dramatic happens, we would normally admit such a patient for telemetric observation, right? You might find something on telemetry that's worrisome. So you do an echo and it looks normal. Has that ruled out hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or ARVC?
Not completely.
Not completely, right? Because you can have hypertrophy that is not seen on echo. Although generally speaking, most of the time the echo will show you something, but particularly for ARVC, the echo absolutely can be negative. I think in children, the vast majority of ARVC, the echo looks normal. And you really need to go to, how would you make a diagnosis, a non-invasive diagnosis of ARVC in a child?
Um, I think, could you see like on like a cardiac MRI?
Yeah, MRI. Like... Yeah, MRI can show dysfunction or wall motion abnormalities or rarely fat infiltration, although in children, again, although that's the classic finding for ARVC, fat infiltration. We don't typically see that in kids because it's usually a later finding. And so our patients are basically too young to have that. But there can see subtle changes. You can also see epsilon waves on the electrocardiogram in V1, although that, in my experience, is very unusual, but that is the classic finding. And there's a whole group of criteria for it. Okay, so let's just say for the sake of discussion, the echo is normal. The you're able to get Jen Cohn to come in on the weekend, and she does a cardiac MRI and tells you, to the best of her ability to know these things, the MRI is normal. The electrocardiogram is normal, but you still have this sort of worrisome finding that multiple people, you know, it was during a high school game, there were hundreds of people in the audience, and they saw this young lady fall to the ground. Someone decides to do a stress test. Is there any benefit? What would the stress test potential? So now we've sort of ruled out, to the best of our ability, ARVC. We have ruled out hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, to the best of our ability. And by the way, there's, do you want to get a family history of any sort?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. You definitely want to get a family history, but it turns out this child's adopted. So we don't have a good family history, unfortunately. But certainly you would want to know if other people in the family have had syncope or if there's any sudden cardiac death or anything like that. Okay, so now it's Monday, so Dr. Arnon has her open lab to do stress tests. So someone decides to do a stress test. So we've ruled out ARVC to some degree. We've ruled out hypertrophic cardiomyopathy to a substantial degree. Now we have a couple of other diagnoses that you already gave to us, which are long QT syndrome, CPVT. I think those are the, could have Brugada syndrome, right? But do Brugada patients typically faint with exertion?
I don't think it's exertion related. I think it's more like fevers and certain drugs and things like that.
Right. Well, yeah. And usually their events occur in sleep, actually. In fact, before the Brugada brothers made the diagnosis, there was, in fact, in certain areas of Southeast Asia, I forget what they used to call it, but it was something like sleeping death disease or something like this. And there were a lot of reports of Southeast Asian people who went to bed and never woke up. Young people. And in retrospect, we are pretty sure that that was Brugada syndrome, just not yet identified as a syndrome. Interesting, right? That there could be a disease that affects human beings that was only identified in the last 20 years. There was no Brugada syndrome 20 years ago. I mean, there was no name for Brugada syndrome. Of course, people had Brugada syndrome, but it is interesting that you could still identify a disease even now. Okay, so it could be Brugada syndrome. So if you, now the electrocardiogram oftentimes in Brugada is normal in appearance. Could you do anything to assess for Brugada?
In this patient or just like in general?
Well, let's just talk in general. So now we have basically, we're down to long QT syndrome, CPVT, Brugada syndrome. Those are sort of our remaining worrisome things. And if we can rule all that out, then maybe we'll say this is some kind of atypical vasovagal or neurocardiogenic syncope. So how would we rule out Brugada syndrome?
So with Brugada, I think you can do like a high EKG, like where
you could put the V1 and V2 an intercostal space up. That will sometimes identify it. That's easy. And that was negative. But
and then you could also, if you're really worried about it, you could go to the EP lab and do like procainamide.
Right. You can give a procainamide challenge, which is a sodium channel blocking agent. And sometimes that will bring out the morphology. what else could we do to just rule out or rule in those other diagnoses? You could also send genetic testing, right? But you would not send genetic testing if you didn't have a high suspicion of it, because the likelihood of it being positive is not high. So why do you think someone decided to do a stress test? Why did Dr. Vinokur do a stress test on this patient? What do you think he was looking for?
I guess he was probably looking for, you know, like CPVT, or even like a long QT syndrome or something to like induce, you know, the arrhythmia that was happening so he could catch it on EKG.
Right. So this is actually a very nice example of a patient who probably has CPVT. So when people with, you know, Dr. Ackerman in the Mayo Clinic has taught everybody this, but lots of people now know it. And I'm not sure if he was the first person to say it, but basically patients with CPVT, when you put them on the treadmill and their sinus rate approaches about 120 beats per minute, they will typically start having lots of PVCs and oftentimes polymorphic VT, or this would sometimes, one of the older fashioned terms, this area here, you would call this bidirectional VT. It's going in one direction and one axis and then upward, so downward and then upward. So this is a very classic finding for somebody who has CPVT. They are essentially having a little run of a polymorphic VT for you right there on the during the stress test. So your initial impulse was absolutely correct, which is that if you have somebody doing that on the treadmill, you should immediately stop the study because they're going to go into VF, or at least they're at high risk to go into VF almost immediately. I well remember when I still follow this young man. He's now a late teenager, but when he was 3 or 4 years old, we couldn't tell what he had. He was a very, very cooperative guy, and we had a treadmill at that time where I was working, and we put him on the treadmill, and he was doing pretty well at the beginning, and he could sense, even though he's like 4 years old, he could sense that we were all nervous about him, and he started to get nervous. And within about 60 seconds of the test, he started having a rhythm very much like this. And it got worse and worse, and we got very nervous, and we immediately stopped the test. And we were so nervous, in fact, that we wouldn't even allow him to walk to the chair, which was 2 feet from the treadmill. We put the chair right on the treadmill and had him sit down, and the tachycardia stopped immediately. So this is a very, very classic demonstration of somebody who has catecholaminergic polymorphic VT. And that is probably the very best way to make the diagnosis, is to do a stress test. Now, if we had long QT syndrome, Sergey, do you have any thoughts on what would happen if the patient had long QT? Is it likely they would have arrhythmia with exertion? Or is there anything else that we might be able to find, either arrhythmia or anything else that would be helpful in making that diagnosis?
I would, again, make sure that we know the family history.
Family history, as we said, we can't get, unfortunately, because this is an adopted child. So what would the stress test, how could a stress test help us?
I'm going to use Molly's phone. Mine is not working. I was saying that the family history would be important to know if any relatives have any cardiac death. It's not working.
No, I can, we can
hear
it.
Oh, it is. Okay. I could hear him echoing at first, and then it stopped. All right. Sorry.
Because Maya's mic is going to.
Yeah.
I don't hear Dutch.
Okay. So, but what about a stress test? Does a stress test help us at all, Sergey?
Long QT syndrome, I don't think so.
Actually, stress tests can be helpful. It's not that obvious, so I understand why you might not know this. But on a stress test, the QT interval can actually prolong in the setting of adrenergic tone. And normally, our QTC will shorten to some degree with exertion if you don't have long QT syndrome. And so one of the ways in which we can sometimes tell if someone has long QT is to see if their QT interval lengthens. So whenever we're doing a stress test on someone who has, let's say, a borderline QT, and we're trying to see if we can bring this out, You'll notice Dr. Arnon take out her calipers and she'll spend like half an hour measuring the QT at different heart rates and calculating QTCs in order to try and see if we could ferret out whether somebody has long QT syndrome. But when you see this type of arrhythmia, you do not normally see this type of induction in somebody who has long QT syndrome, but this is classic for CPVT. So, all right, so you now can send the genetic testing, but that takes a long time to come back. What would you do now in managing this patient? So Molly, you have the, Maya has done a stress test. She went on vacation. So she asked you if you could follow the patient while she's away in Aruba. And you're on call on Monday, and you've now gotten this test back that Maya ordered appropriately. And you now have to go into the room and tell the family that their child has CPVT. What are you going to do to help this child now? What's the next step?
So we disclose the diagnosis to them, and then I think that you can, I don't think it's a great candidate for EP, but I could be wrong in terms of ablation, but I could be definitely wrong on that. But to discuss like starting them on like a beta blocker.
Right. So this is a channelopathy, right? So generally speaking, channelopathies, there's not much role for ablation. Although there are increasing numbers of reports of Brugada patients having ablations in their RV outflow tract, and similarly ARVC patients can sometimes benefit from ablations. But I think that's still out there in the unusual category for the management. But yeah, it's the classic and the most important treatment for CPVT is absolutely beta blockade. And you would normally give a very high dose, typically between 2 and 3 per kilo. And now when you get to adult size, those numbers break down, but a patient who's adult size, you would probably put a minimum of 40 of nadolol, maybe 60, maybe more. What you would do is you would put them on 40 to 60, probably start with 40 because nadolol makes you a little tired and you have to adjust to it. But once you're on a proper dose, we would usually do a stress test again in order, we would do a Holter to see that we have a nice heart rate blunting, but we would probably do a stress test in order to confirm that this does not happen. What about an ICD in a patient like this? I mean, this patient, what like in CPVT, right? What happens is that this polymorphic VT presumably degenerates into ventricular fibrillation. And for whatever reason, probably we can surmise that this patient that fainted maybe was in polymorphic VT, had low brain perfusion, fainted, but upon falling to the ground, maybe the tachycardia terminated and so the patient woke up. But obviously the concern is that the VT will degenerate to VF and cause sudden cardiac arrest or death. So obviously a potentially life-threatening condition. So does a patient like this merit an ICD?
I think they could.
Yeah, some people like, do.
I mean, yeah, like you said, like to me, if you're thinking about them having like an arrest, which I know this person did not have an arrest, but knowing what you have from the stress testing and everything else with the history, like I think some people would maybe want to put one in then for the concern of them having an event that could have led to arrest.
Well, I certainly understand where you're coming from, right? No one ever wants to have a patient who fainted from a life-threatening problem then go ahead and die after you've made the diagnosis. But actually, for CPVT, generally speaking, we would not recommend defibrillator as a first-line therapy. Dr. Ackerman and other experts are very adamant about this because the majority of these patients can be very well controlled with beta blockade. And aggressive beta blockade and may not ever have any arrhythmia when they're on board with it. Interestingly, recently a paper came out that CPVT patients, not all, but some, have developmental delays or are not as normal neurologically as other patients. That is not universal by any stretch, but there's a higher incidence than that. And I have to say, in my experience, I have observed that in a lot of my patients who have this, and they tend to be a little non-compliant. But one of the concerns that we have about putting defibrillators in these patients is, you know, if you had polymorphic VT, you don't necessarily faint from that. And the device may sense it and shock the patient. And if the patient is shocked while awake, it may raise the catecholamine level and make the arrhythmia worse. And you could have what's sometimes referred to as an ICD or a VT storm, where the defibrillator's shocks are making it worse. Patient actually is more agitated, is very frightened by the shocks, is in pain from the shocks, and actually, the arrhythmia gets worse. So often, a lot of the bigger experts in this field would say that the first thing we should do is put the patient on a high-dose beta blockade. And if that were to fail, some might argue or advocate for a stellate ganglionectomy to really try and reduce the adrenergic tone on the heart itself before going to ICD, with ICD being used as a sort of last-line therapy for somebody like this. Interestingly, Josie and I follow a patient who, this same patient I mentioned earlier, who had syncope as a small boy with exertion, and interestingly presented with a Brugada pattern on his electrocardiogram. And as a result, we made the diagnosis. We thought he had Brugada syndrome. Interestingly, it had happened multiple times. And the father and mother even brought a video in of him running from first to second base in like a little peewee 4-year-old baseball clinic. And you watch him faint with this. So we actually put an ICD in that guy thinking he had Brugada syndrome. And he was too small initially for us to do any kind of stress test. But because his ECG was so classic for Brugada, we assumed that's what he had. But in fact, he continued to have episodes of arrhythmia and was in fact shocked multiple times from his ICD, and which documented VT. And when he got to age five or six, was when we put him on the treadmill and we saw this. And then we realized, now remember that for Brugada, we don't treat with beta blockers. There's no medical therapy except rare cases where they have other arrhythmias. Sometimes we give them quinidine. But the point is, we don't usually start medical therapy for patients with Brugada, and we certainly don't put them on beta blockers. So if we think someone has Brugada, but then they continue to have lots of episodes, so in that case, we identified from the stress test, we had a tracing very similar to the one that we're looking at here. We put the patient on beta blockers, and he has now gone 15 years without having an episode, documented episode of more than like a couplet on Holters and on the recordings from his ICD. And so now, as his ICD is approaching the elective replacement interval, we are asking ourselves whether we need to replace the device or not in somebody who has had, you know, well over a decade of good arrhythmia control on a solid dose of beta blockade. And, at some point, we're going to need to bite the bullet and make a decision as to whether we want to take the device out and cap the lead or whether we want to replace it. So it's an interesting question. It's not so simple. You might say, well, just replace the device, except, you know, it's given that he's now over 6 feet tall, and we put this device in when he was 5.5 or 6. Amazingly, the lead is still working very well with adequate sensing and pacing, et cetera. But if that lead were to break, which we pretty much can guarantee at some point, and he were to get an inappropriate shock, it could in fact be dangerous for the patient. So the bottom line is, and the most important aspect of this case is, first of all, somebody has syncope while playing, and it's very important to get a careful history to confirm that it is definitively during the actual act of playing. That is a worrisome observation, and it really requires a very intense evaluation. That is not a syncopal episode that you want to blow off. And then finally, the other very important point is this very classic tracing of somebody who's having what appears to be CPVT or polymorphic VT with elevation in adrenergic tone. This is a classic example of how the stress test can be very, very, very helpful to make that diagnosis. It's very pathognomonic. Does anybody have any questions about any of that?
Dr. Press, is there any exercise restriction for those patients after you start them on beta blockers?
That's a very good question. Well, I think that, you know, it always seems to be that it's the kid who's the captain of the basketball team who has this happen. And so that question comes up with some regularity. And I think that, you know, at the beginning of my career, we would routinely say, no, you cannot participate in competitive athletics. You have a life-threatening condition. Don't do that. Your chances of having an arrhythmia will be less. I think that that was true, that you definitely are less likely to have an arrhythmia if you're not doing activity like that. But you know, increasingly what we're learning is that if patients take their beta blockade properly at high enough dose, if there's an AED at courtside, that it is unusual for people to have a serious problem. And some would say that the benefits of participation, et cetera, are so great that it outweighs the risk of this. This falls into the category of shared decision-making, where the family and the electrophysiologist together make a decision regarding how important this is for the patient's mental health, et cetera. So for sure, we would let people who have this condition exercise. Whether we would allow them to be on a competitive sports team, I think for sure a good in-between approach might be to do a repeat stress test when really aggressively beta blocked, and in order to confirm the absence of this arrhythmia. But I think it's important that all involved parties need to be aware that although the risk is much lower if you're on a high dose of beta blocker and you've had a negative stress test on beta blockade, it is unfortunately not the case that it is 100% protective. And so patients, families, schools, officials all need to be aware that although this is likely to be a safe approach, there is unfortunately no zero danger to this. So I would sort of probably, I would try to feel out from the family how important the participation is. And if it's really, really critically important, then I would probably very aggressively beta block and I would retest to confirm that everything looked okay. And then I would have the long conversation in which I said, listen, you have to understand that although I think it is likely it'll be okay, it is not a guarantee. And the family and the child have to decide whether they want to assume that risk. Any other questions? All right, this was a long question, but I thought we got through a lot of interesting topics in regards to it. So I think we're going to stop here. Thanks so much for joining, and I'll see you all at Sinai in a little while. Have a great day, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.